It's lovely to be here, and it's always a privilege to talk to the very people who are not only our customers and clients, but who are the people who hold our life and our work in their hands. And as Anna said, you know, I actually belong to the WCL company. But rather than give you an entire back CV, let me just say to you that my life and my work for the past 20 odd years, so you'll now have worked out that I'm actually 22, has been early years. I've been working with early years for a long time, not just with the Department for Education in the UK, but also with ministries of education all over the world. And back in the UK, and this is the thing I try not to tell teachers in any of our schools, I'm an Ofsted inspector, so part of my work is to make sure that schools are doing the right thing from the very youngest children right the way through. My key remit is minus 9 months to about 8, but it will go beyond that. So it's just to say to you that anything I say to you, I would say to any school, any group of people, anywhere in the world, because I think it's absolutely true about early years children. And I'm really glad that there are some children here this morning, because they'll vote with their feet when they get bored, they'll start to cry. And thank you for bringing one that's just hatching. And the other bit of my credential that's really important to me is, and I know you'll be shocked, I'm a grandmother. Thank you, that was polite humour. It worked with me. My grandchildren are basically 2 years old, 3 years old, 4 years old, and 6 year old. And they are my greatest joy. Forget the fact that your children are very bright. Not a hope against my grandchildren. But they've all been through a variety of school systems, some school systems and nursery systems. And what I want you to know is that what I say, I would expect for my grandchildren. Because I want them to go on into a world where they get fabulous jobs, where they're very well-rounded people, and they get a really good shot at it. And the reason I'm saying that to you is because it's really interesting. The more work I do, and I work with industry and commerce as well, what's interesting is people have stopped putting out job descriptions, role descriptions, that now ask for only the qualifications. People like Google, Apple, big law firms, big banks are looking at people who have the kind of qualifications that your 2, 3, 4, and 5 year olds are developing. Because they're going into a world that we have absolutely no concept of. And I look back to my own days in nursery and preschool, no computer, no laptop, no iPod, sand tray, a bit of water, but nothing that prepared me for the world. I trained as a teacher, I didn't train to work internationally, it kind of just happened. So we have to have children who are absolutely responsive to all of that, but who are also equipped for the kind of qualification system that is out there as well. Because I guess there isn't one of you here today who doesn't want their child to go to a top university and get a fab job, correct? And it's purely because you don't.
It's not the goal.
Okay, happy children then,
yes,
whatever.
Yes. Okay. Self-sufficient and satisfied.
But tell me now that you're not wanting them to prepare for you in your old age. Yeah, so that's what you need to have. Okay. So I get you, but that's what I'm saying to you. And that's true. The hardest thing for parents, I think, is here because this is a laptop that is not my one. We've got to realise that children are all individuals. That they're not all in one mould. It's not like opening a pack of biscuits. They're all very, very different. And I think what we have to do is recognise that and try not to work so hard to put our own ambition on them, that will develop their ambition. Let me share a story with you. I was doing some work on this in the Middle East, working with Qatar University, and I had a group of student teachers with me, and they were very much going down the road, this is what I want my child to be, this is what I want my child to do, so I have to push them in this direction, push them in that direction. And after a while, one of the student teachers said to me, oh, I'm starting to get it now, Pam. You're saying that if I wanted my child to be a doctor, what I mustn't do is try and push him into that kind of road. I must look at what he's really interested in and help him to develop that skill, as along with every other academic skill. Great, you got it. I said, how old is your child? She said, we don't have any children yet. That's preparing my thoughts. So, what I think I'd like to say to you is, you know, we have no idea where these children are going, no idea what kind of memories they'll take with them into the future. But I know one thing, people have the strongest memories about their earliest years. Do you remember being in school yourself as a child, very young child? Some of us are, what, forgive me, I was going to say some of us way older than that now. Tell me what your memories are. Nothing at all, Pam, we didn't go to school.
So, I went from Montessori to public school. I can remember everything about Montessori and almost nothing from the public school.
Okay, so what's your best memory of Montessori?
Weird sounds really weird. Shapes, putting it in.
Great stuff. But may I ask what you do for a living? How interesting. Putting shapes into things, and you're an engineer. And in some way, there is a connection there. Yeah? Somebody else? Come on, even if you only remember the fluffy toy that you played with, it's okay.
I'm in the blind bubbles and she'll throw a straw into the mudroom.
Yeah, okay. Great fun. Yeah? So it has to be fun, but what you were learning then is the basis of who and what you are now. And I have on there rich children. I don't mean children who are financially rich, I mean children who are holistically rich, who are great people, who are great communicators. Who are great learners, who are resilient, yeah, absolutely, who are resilient, who can actually work with others, and who are going to be ready for the world that they're going into. Now, that's what this school is doing in bucket loads for your children. Now, some of you will be sitting there saying, well, you're bound to say that you work for a company. I don't have to say it, I can say what I like. But I absolutely believe that they're working very hard to develop the kind of curriculum and learning that's not only appropriate for all children, but specifically for your individual children. Yeah. Let me tell you what I mean. There are only, in my book, in my mind, four key things that you ever need to think about with very young children. And again, this is something that's happening here. First of all, every child in the school is treated as an individual. So, and I hope you'll forgive me for this, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes when parents get together in a group, the panic rises. You look at which book your friend's children have got, even which toy they are playing with in school, and there's that, what, not all going the same direction. Who's feeling guilty now? It's okay, I do the same. But actually, can I take away the panic, the guilt, or the fear, and just say that because this school is way ahead of the cutting edge of where good early years practice is, your children are individuals and their needs are being catered for. And what we will ask you to do to support them at home is at an individual level. So you can forget looking at what everybody else is bringing home from school. Think about what your child needs. And no two children, even your own two children, or three children, four children, are the same. So what we look at is how complex individual children are. Who they are. So if you think in the first few weeks of a toddler, or if your child has just joined the school in nursery or reception, you haven't had it back yet, where are we? That's because we take a lot of time to know who your children are, to know who they are as people, first and foremost, because that's important, to know who and what they like to do, who they like to work with, and how they learn best. Because in an earlier setting, and there are people now at Harvard University who are looking at early years children so that they can design office premises appropriately, because that's the way early years children work. There's a guy called Mitch Resnick is doing a lot of work on that. It's about how idiosyncratic very young children are and how it works best for them. So what we provide is resources, what we ask them to do, and we always put the next step just ahead. But to do that, we need to know who they are, so we spend an awful lot of time working with them. The other thing is the way that we want children to be independent. It fascinates me because I work in lots of schools where very small children, if they're hot, will take off their jumper. And then they get to about 15 and go, it's okay if I take off my sweater. And then it'll be hot. So somewhere, you need to keep nurturing that independence. And unless we know who the children are, which is why we spend a lot of time looking at them and watching them and working with them, we're never going to know what they need to do. And the relationships are absolutely key, particularly in the early years. Great, huge amounts of research on attachment at the moment, how children attach to parents, how they attach to the adults who work with them during the day. If children aren't secure in a setting, And this little chap here is very happy. He's having a great time. I think he's actually got himself a girlfriend. unless we really create good, strong relationships, we won't go anywhere with the children. And it's really important that you work in partnership with your children's teachers. Children know if there's a tension there. They sense it very quickly. So we need to really work together on that. And this one is absolutely key. We talk about enabling environments, and that means the actual room, the space that children are learning in, is critical to enable them to be independent. So when you collect or drop off your child, if you have to come in during the day, and it looks as though the children are milling about all around the room, and you think, why aren't you sitting down with the children teaching them something? Actually, the very best learning takes place when children are accessing activities independently, with skillful interaction from adults. Sometimes you'll see them working together in a group, or in a pair, or with one adult. That's great. But a lot of the time, you'll see them moving around the room and accessing things for themselves. And that's absolutely critical. You'll also notice that we spend a lot of time outdoors with the children. Children behave differently outdoors than they do indoors. Their learning is different. And particularly for boys, but not always, particularly for boys, the outdoors is really important. Sitting down with a piece of paper and writing numbers doesn't really do it for most boys. Being outside, chalking the same numbers on the floor, because that would be just a little bit naughty. It really does. So when they come home and they chalk all over your walls, don't worry about it. I made a fatal error once as an early years teacher and saying to the children, and now you can do your letters. You can practice them on any piece of paper. And the next morning, I had a very irate dad in my room going, my daughter has just written her name all over the walls in her bedroom, and we've just papered it. Your fault. Did she form the letters correctly? But this one is also, if you can't see it, let me read it to you, the importance of interconnection of all aspects of learning. This school uses the international primary curriculum as well as the British curriculum. It's important that in the early years, children see learning as a whole. Very young children don't go, ooh, I'm learning about science today. Ooh, I'm learning about my maths today. They come home and they say to you, I played all day. And you think, I'm paying all this money, they're playing. Great, I hope they are, because that means they're absolutely connecting the different strands of their learning. That is absolutely key. So they'll still have their reading, they'll still have their number, they'll still have the rudiments of science, but they will be learning it in a way that actually suits them and the different ways that they access learning. I guess you probably heard of a gentleman called James Dyson. Yeah, the guy who invented, I keep saying he invented the Hoover, he didn't. You know, he invented the thing that you put on the carpet and the thing that takes the skin off your hands in the loo when you dry them. His school report when he was 5 years old said, if James spent less time playing about and more time concentrating, he would do a lot better. Really? Multi-millionaire is quite good, isn't it? It's not the be-all and end-all. He was a very creative, very hands-on child who didn't want to be sitting at a table drawing around letter shapes. That came later. But look where he is now. Not everyone can be James Dyson. Heard of David Beckham? Yeah. You have heard of David Beckham. I used to be able to say he was a top-class footballer. He's just retired. Thanks, David. Great stuff. He would have failed miserably in many academic pursuits because he wasn't that kind of child. Some years ago, I used to work with his aunt. I never met him, sadly. I used to work with his aunt, and she said to me one day, you know, Pam, if someone hadn't recognised that David was sporty, if he hadn't had the kind of learning environment where he could show his skills and talents, he probably would have been in serious trouble as an adult because he just wasn't going down that channel. So what I'm saying is celebrate who and what the children are. And that's what we do here. We find out where they are independently and we look at them as a whole person. While I'm saying that, let me just say something else. Sometimes we ask for children to perhaps stay in one particular class, perhaps stay with the toddler program before they're quite ready to move up to the next stage of nursery. Let me reassure you why that is important. Sometimes children's skills develop like this. If you've got a graph, they're like that. You can't say that all children develop in the same way. So for some children, we might need to keep them for social or personal development reason in one class for a little longer, but we make sure that the academic expectations of them are at the level which they are. So let me say to you, if that happens to your child, don't panic. It's for all of the right reasons, not the reasons that my child isn't doing well. I hope that you can talk to me. Tell me when you doze off and we'll just do some gymnastics or something. The reason is this. Again, this is from some of the work that's being done on attachment and looking at children's development. Look at the sensitive periods of brain development. Look at where the big curve is. I don't know how well you can see it, so... and this is their age in years at the bottom, so from birth to 7 years old. Look at where the greatest learning takes place.
It's amazing that so often the early years are thought of, well, the all of education starts in kindergarten in a lot of people's minds.
Yeah.
And that's all gone.
Yeah, absolutely. And the problem is, and in the UK I often say, you know, life begins at key stage one. No bother about what happened before that. Hey, that's much too late. So biggest development, look at the hearing, vision, the pink one, the emotional control, look at that piece. So the reason we spend a lot of time with children, helping them to develop social skills alongside their academic skills, is absolutely that. If you can't share the beads or the toys in the water tray, you're going to really struggle when you get here. If you don't develop oral language skills, if you can't think and reason and problem solve, it's really difficult to apply that as you get older. And the other one I want to mention to you is this. I know you can all read, but it would be great if somebody could actually tell me what that says. Anybody? Nobody speaks language. I told you that it says child, and then I give you a copy of it. And then tomorrow you come back to me and I show it again. Would you be able to tell me what it said? Yeah? I can read it to take away. Yeah? So you learn it, so you learn the symbols, and it says child. You come back tomorrow morning and tell me what it says. Actually, it doesn't say anything, because I made up those symbols. But what happens with young children is they learn some words, they learn to recognise words, they put them together, and we think they're reading. They're not. They're memorising symbols. Before we learn to read properly, we need to have all the skills. And the other example I give you is, how many of you can drive? Drive a car. After a fashion, yes, we all can. Thank you. There's a bit of embarrassment there. You can drive. Yeah. You can drive, but actually, if I gave you the keys to the most fabulous car in the world, and you don't have the skills of driving, you've got about 5 minutes of pleasure while you turn the key and listen to the engine. And that's it. Unless you've done the skills-based learning of driving, you are not going to be able to take the best car in the world and enjoy it. And it's exactly the same with reading, mathematics, with anything that requires skills to be learned. So that's why sometimes we say to you, perhaps we're not going to take them on in their reading yet, because we don't think they've got the building blocks. Same with writing. A lot of parents say to me, so how shall I help my child learn to write their letters? My answer is always the same. Get them a bike and let them ride around cones and tracks. Let them make big circles in the air. Give them a detergent bottle with water in it and let them make shapes on a concrete surface. That's about writing. And then they'll be ready to transfer that skill in a classroom environment. You with me still? Mm-hmm. Tell me when you've lost the will to live, Nasser. Okay, so we have some very young children in school, which is great. And we work hard to make sure that they develop all the skills, but most of all that they are comfortable and confident learners. And we aim to communicate with you about their progress, but don't panic, as I said to you earlier. Don't worry if you're not getting lots of information about how they're doing with their numbers and their reading and their writing. Because at this point, we're more interested in their global development. How they are in terms of creative work, how they are in terms of their learning hands-on, how they work with other children, how they learn together, how they share, and how how they socialise. That's the most important thing. And once we've got all that shored up, then we can work with them on the rest of their skills. This is the critical period. 2 years old, between 2 and 3, huge amounts of development in terms of their hearing, their vision, as you saw on the slide before, particularly critical for language acquisition. Really, really important. If you miss that critical period, it doesn't mean they won't learn language, or they won't learn to speak, or they won't learn to socialise, but it's much easier when they're at this age. No two-year-olds are the same. No two children of 18 months are the same. They develop at different rates in different ways. And these are key things that we want from our very youngest children in the nursery. See them there. We want children who are watching, listening, engaging. One of the teachers at the school this morning, as we all do, was showing me a fabulous video clip of his little son, 18 months old, working out how, with his hands full, when he dropped the little lantern, how he could work out how to pick it up without letting go of everything else. Phenomenal learning. And out of the corner of my eye, I'm seeing some phenomenal learning going on here with these two little children who are socialising in this room. So that's important. And we want them to be able to copy, to mimic, memorise activities. We want all that for them, and the environment that we have in the toddler room is exactly what we want. So when you see them out there in the garden, or when you see them in the learning environment, and think, why aren't they sitting down? Why aren't they doing this? Working the worksheet? No point in that at all. Most paper for very young children isn't worse than the printing time that it took, because it needs to come from the children. Then they're operating at a level higher than that of which any of us think they are in. How many of you like to watch a film when you sit in a restaurant?
No.
Yeah. How do you do it? How do you watch things?
No.
It is interesting, isn't it? Watching young children learn is interesting. I'm going to talk to you about assessment in a moment, but a lot of what we know about young children are learning and where they are and where we need to go next is actually through what they do. If they don't do it with joy, like this little girl, then they're not. And they pick up pressure and tension from parents. A parent a few weeks ago came and said, I'm really worried about my child, I'm really worried. He's not learning to read. I sit with him every night. We get home, sit him down with his book, and we read. And he won't do it. He can't, he struggles. And I said, what do you do for a living? I work in a bank. I'm a manager of a bank, a subsidiary of Deutsche Bank. I said, so when you get home at night, if we give you 5 minutes just to take your jacket off, and then we go, right, okay, I'd like to go through all those figures again for me now, what would you say? He said, oh no, I don't do that stuff in the evening. That's exactly what you're doing to your child. He's had a hard day playing and learning, and he's just come home, and he wanted to do the same again. Give him the play. I'm not saying don't do it, but give the space. And then children really develop the skills that you're looking for. It's really important that you don't get anxious about it. So that's what we're doing. We're growing children who are independent learners and thinkers. And there's nothing like the opinions of a 2 and 3 year old to really rock your world. Can I talk about play just for a few minutes? There's an awful lot of fear, I think, from many schools and lots of parents about play. We talk about you can go and play when you've done your whatever it is. Well, actually, play is children learning work. It's the medium through which most great inventions in the world have come about, and it's the thing that makes children or enables children to really take in and absorb through fun, but this is their serious learning context. A study has been done in the States fairly recently, a longitudinal study, to see the impact of play on children and as they go through their lives, from pre-birth, obviously just looking at the conception and the whole the time in the womb, but from birth right the way up to 16. Two things came out of that study. One, that children who play and learn to play from a very early age are the children who achieve the higher academic standards. And the other was that there are only two groups of creatures in the entire world who do not naturally play. One are reptiles as very young animals. They don't play in the same way that primates do, in the same way that big cats do. And the other group, sadly, because this study was done alongside adults, the other group that don't naturally play or are unable to play are prisoners serving long-term sentences for murder, which is scary. They still don't know how to play. So whenever people say to me, I'm really worried, I don't know what's playing going on, so, you know, when I come home and I play, it's cool. The other thing I want to say to you is, can we allow our children to take some risks? Because when they take risks, they are phenomenally skilled. Vygotsky, a psychologist, talked about the zone of proximal development for very young children. What he meant is watching where they are and just tipping them into the next stage of learning or risk. And we have become a risk-averse society. There's a great book, if you haven't read it, ladies and gentlemen, I really recommend it to you. It's by an American lady, a broadcaster. It's called Free Range Kids. Fabulous book, and at the end of each chapter, it gives you three levels of risk, so it depends how brave you are and what you let your kids do. But these pictures are really going to spend a long time. Fabulous time here for very young children. Looks as though they're just getting really messy on the mudslide. The language development from that activity was phenomenal. And it impacted on their writing, their wanting to write, their skills in expressing themselves, because it was fun and it all came out. These children, pouring down with rain, really heavy rain. The teacher took them outside with some umbrellas. Nobody had their eye poked out with an umbrella because they said, please don't hit each other with the umbrellas. But actually, some of the umbrellas are covered with aluminum foil, and the sound of rain on an umbrella covered with aluminum foil makes a real difference. And the children were excited. They came out with wonderful words, went back into the classroom, and together they wrote the most phenomenal poetry you could imagine. That would never have happened if someone had said, right, I'm going to ask you now to write a poem about rain for me. This little girl here, I don't know how clearly you can see it. She's balancing on some rolled up logs around a water feature. Now, we all worry about water for the obvious reason. You can drown in 2 inches. This is about her motor control, her gross and fine motor control, her balance, and her head steadying. If you never have the experience of going downhill or balancing, you struggle to learn to read because it doesn't help you to use both of your eyes in tandem. Your brain hasn't developed that skill. We want children to run like nothing on earth downhill. We want them to roll. We want them to balance. I happened to be inspecting this school with another colleague, and we saw the little girl on there, and there's a teacher just out of sight, just here, so if she did slip, she could be caught. And the inspector with me said, Pam, I really don't like that. And he said to the teacher, I'm really worried about that. It's incredibly high. And the teacher never missed a beat. She looked him straight in the eye and said, it is, but if you want to have a go, let the girl hold your hand. So it's important that all this play stuff is there. And we want children to play and explore, because that's their engagement in learning. So the reading skills, the writing skills, the number skills, the calculation skills, all come through a lot of play-based learning. And also, some direct teaching. Let's not be foolish about this. Children don't just learn to read by osmosis. There was a theory some years ago that if you just gave children gorgeous books, they'd learn to read. Really. Not unless they have the phonics skills, not unless they have the decoding skills, not unless they have the skills of constructing a sentence. Then they can learn to read. That was by the by. Just by the by, this just looks like a photograph of three children carrying a board. They're actually trying to get it to the chair across the far side of the room. You have no idea the complexity of what's going on there. They're carrying a board with a model that they've made out of clay. None of them speak each other's language. This little girl chats 19,000 Spanish. This boy is from Thailand. This one isn't yet really communicating verbally, but they were negotiating how to get that board across to that chair. It took them about 15-20 minutes, because nobody wanted to walk backwards for the obvious reasons. Nobody was going to let go for the obvious reasons. And they had to get it balanced. Now, you could look at that and go, what a waste of time. They couldn't do some math while they're doing that. They were figuring out spatial awareness. They were figuring out balance. The adult with them was giving them some of the words of what they were doing. And by the time they got to the chair, they'd worked all that out, and all of them had learned some new patterns because of the purpose of doing it. We also want children to be active learners, but there has to be a reason for doing it. You know, what's in it for me? When am I going to get out of this? This little girl, I always use this photograph for active learning because people say, yeah, she's just pouring water. Big deal. Big deal. This is all about her wonderful skills. This is all about her hand control, her steadying, her concentration. Every child on that table got a glass of water and none was spilled. I don't think even as an adult I could do that. Because she wanted to do it, she needed to do it, and she'd been encouraged and she'd been able to share that skill. Critical stuff. And we also want children who could think critically. So a play-based curriculum within the international primary curriculum that children have when they go on into reception, we want them to be able to think critically and not just accept stuff. Now that's hard as a parent, isn't it? When you let your child go to school for the first time, and up until then you have been the absolute apple of their eye. Your word is law, you are wonderful, and they go to school. And suddenly it's, Miss Mangel said, I have to do it this way. And it's not the way you want them to do it. Because they become very different. We help them to think differently. We help them to be creators. We help them to struggle. I really want your children to struggle. And I mean that in the kindest way. I want them to want to learn the next thing. And they will never do that if everything they do is just writing in a book, doing their numbers in a book. That's important, but it's the balance. So the other thing that I know taxes us as parents and teachers is, so how do you know how well they're doing? How do you know what to give them next to do? And these are the three questions that I always ask teachers to think about. When I go into a learning environment, I'm going to be in classrooms today having a look at what's happening. Question in my head is, are they busy or are they busy learning? And what's the difference? Because you can see children playing and thinking, okay, they are learning. Are they really? It takes a very skilled teacher to interpret that play and know exactly what that child needs next. And we also want to know, you know, how do you know that the learning we're offering is right for your child? You may have a child who's a fantastic mathematician. You may have a child who's fantastically creative. How do we know that we're taking them on to the next steps of that, and how do we know we're providing what they actually need? And then, is it challenging? Is it sufficient for where your child is, and how do we take them to the next step? How do you do it? There's actually only one real way of measuring, and that's by observing them when they're playing. Now, we can do it when we're sitting with them doing an activity, and that's great, but most of what we know about what children know, understand, and are able to do is actually when they're playing, we observe them, or we interact. That means that we have to keep some stuff about them. Now, I'm hoping that you probably saw one of these. Yeah, good. That bit's working then. This is the most comprehensive record of a child's achievement and where they're going next that you will ever see in any year group, in any school. Because this carries the children through right from the point at which they join the top group to the point at which they move on into nursery reception, and for some children on into year one if they are still completing the early years part of their learning. And what's in here, probably just a bit further on, we went smaller because the teachers couldn't manage the big books. What's in here are fantastic photographs, and I'm sure you can have a look at this one later. Samples of what the children are learning, things that they've produced, for want of a better word. I tend not to use the word work. The little notes that you can see here are the so what moments in the children's learning. So significant, key bits of learning go into this book. So you will see photographs, you will see comments from the teacher, you will see some longer observations that teachers have made of the children, so where they stand back and they watch what the children are doing in the learning environment, and then they plan the next steps in your child's learning from what has been seen. And if you think that's really odd because there are no test scores, well, there won't be any test scores. This is ongoing. This is a higher level assessment than you probably see in any other year group. I'm not suggesting teachers higher at school aren't doing their job. Of course they are. But this is consistent, constantly picking up what children are doing, and only the absolute key moments going here. And we will ask you, I guess you have already, to contribute to this, because your children at home will do different things than they do in school. So they might have a wow moment at home. Not necessarily, you know, doing part of their A-level maths at three, but they may well have done something really phenomenal for them. They may have stayed in their own bed for the whole night, or they may have done some pre-writing. Share it with your teacher. Share it with the teachers. We need to see that. And that becomes a part of this. That becomes a part of this, because this is a whole record of your children's learning in all areas. Maths, language arts, creative, personal, social, all of the skills that children develop in the early years, including their personal, social, and emotional development. And we call them their, learning journals. Quick question for you. This piece of learning was done by a child of 4 years old. It took her 2 or 3 days to do it. She did other things in between. Nobody stood over and made her do it. I just wonder what you could see in that picture. Okay, we're getting dinosaurs. I won't say yes or no to them.
Writing.
Okay, some writing, some dinosaurs.
Hands and feet.
Okay. Yeah, it's got some three dimensions there, yeah.
People.
Okay, another trick. The reason I ask you the question is because I'm now going to tell you what this child said about this piece of learning. So we've got the comments, dinosaurs, some writing, it's 3D, it's got hands and feet. When the teacher asked this little girl to talk about what she created, this is what she said. Some of the words she used, I'm going to use. I'll paraphrase some of it. She said, there are three mountains. She said, this one is a mountain of the past. She's 4 years old. This is the mountain of the past. Some animals lived a long time ago. I don't know what they're called, but you can't see them anymore. Something happened and you can't see them. She then went to this one and said, this is the mountain of the future, her words. This is the mountain of the future. I can't go there yet because I'm not grown up. And I've written some letters. I don't know what they say because I can't read yet. This in the middle is where I am. This is the mountain of now. I can't go back and climb to the past because it's gone. I can't go to the future because it's not there yet. I will when I'm a big girl. 4 years old. You know what? Her mum looked at that and said, why are you doing that? Because she can't spell. Why are you doing that? And I have a child with that phenomenal level of language. The concept of past, present, and future. Who knows that she can't do that? That's pretty good, isn't it? Now, what the teacher did is go, okay, so she can form those letters. Let's do some word building. And went from there. Yeah? So that's what I mean by children developing their own skills, but skilled teachers who know when to take them to the next steps of reading, writing, calculation, mathematics, social awareness, right at the point when they will fly, absolutely fly. And that's where it's recorded, the learning journal that I just showed you. Great picture, isn't it? Dr. Margaret Carr, you've seen two quotations from her now, but actually what we have to do, and this is where I really want to stop today, we have to make sure that we make sense of where children are in their learning. that we take them absolutely to the next point that they are ready for, that we don't get anxious, that we don't panic, but we don't lose the rich complexity of their learning and behaviour. So what I want to say to you is, that's what this school is doing. If you have questions about it, I'm very happy to answer them. But don't forget to talk to your teachers as well. And above all, enjoy your children. So if they're three now, they need to enjoy being three before they're four. I don't know about you, but I never look forward to my next birthday. Perhaps that's an age. But allow them to be who they are now. Support the teachers. Let them support you too. But really value the quality that's happening.